I'm trying to get all my things lined up the way they need to be.
I highly approve of your first screen.
Thank you. Thank you. I thought that your husband might.
I have no doubt.
What happened to chat? Somehow I lost the chat window.
Down at the bottom?
No, because it's somewhere under my, there it is. Okay. Because of the way I have my monitor set up.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, there we go. Everybody, I hope everybody is here. We'll give it another minute. Go ahead. You can unmute yourselves. Just make sure that you don't have a lot of background noise, because this is not a listen to me talk. This is an interactive class. I'm going to make you talk back to me. And I see nobody is unmuting themselves. Dulcia, do they have the ability to unmute?
All right, I'm unmuted.
Hey, oh. Yay!
I was playing music to myself, so.
Okay. As long as everybody has the ability to unmute themselves, that's good.
Everybody has the ability. I cannot unmute anybody.
Okay, FYI. That's fine. Okay, we're going to start in a minute. I'm just going to give another minute for late people to show up. I figure a 12 o'clock class that starts at 12:05 for the SCA is doing pretty good, right? There's my apprentice.
Hey, Ma.
Late as always.
I was super conflicted because I've got you doing Latin and GLaDOS doing quarters and stuff. So I popped in to check on her, make sure she was okay, and now I'm here.
Okay, all right. Okay, so my clock's up. We still a few seconds. We're going to start at 12:05, allowing late people to show up.
Ursula!
All right, we're going to start. Okay, so hi. You can't see me because I'm sharing my screen. I don't think you can see me, but I probably show up in the little mini head things if you see those, depending on how you have your stuff set up. When it looks like I'm looking off to the side, that's when I'm actually looking at you guys, because I have a dual screen system set up so that I can actually read things, because it's really important for me to be able to read this as we're teaching. So when I'm looking over there, I'm not actually looking away from you. I'm actually looking to see if people are participating. So I would love it if you, those of you who have cameras, would turn them on so I can actually see you. And if those of you who have the ability to unmute yourselves and use a microphone, if you would go ahead and do that, because this is an interactive class.
Okay.
Okay. And if anybody wants to know what a nauta is, a nauta is the Latin word for sailor. So, you know, learn how to swear like a sailor. I am notorious Countess Dulcia, Laurel Pelican Rose, former territorial Baroness, Kingdom Sundial Herald, and General Troublemaker. In case you haven't already figured this out, Latin is a really difficult language to learn because there's rules about everything. And then they made rules about the rules. And then they broke them all. So yeah, it's crazy. If you read a lot, you probably already know more Latin than you realize. And as a personal note, I took Latin in high school, starting as a freshman, 38 years ago. And in those days, they taught ecclesiastical pronunciation, not classical pronunciation. So about a year ago, I suddenly realized that I didn't know enough Latin to be able to do the research that I wanted to do. So I started trying to relearn it as a reading exercise. And then I discovered that I've been pronouncing all of this stuff wrong. So when I make mistakes in this class, it's because I'm still relearning too. And I am not an expert in Latin. I don't even try to deal with cases and tenses that we don't deal with normally in English because, yeah, it's just too screwy. Anyway, going on. So if you haven't already looked at the class, this slide is an homage to, if you haven't looked at the handout, don't kill me. It's 4 pages long. I know it's long, but it's sort of a resource for you. There is also a second class handout that is, if you print it out, when you go to print it out, set it up to print out as a booklet, because you can fold it into a half page booklet and it will turn into like a little carry around with you phrases sheet. And there's even room in there to write notes for things that you want to call people and stuff. The grammar section in the back of the handout is to help you in case you want to write your own things to say to people. Because I put no limits on what you can say to people in Latin, because, you know, barbarians deserve what they get. And by the way, barbarian means pants wearer. So that's all of those non-Romans to you.
Barbarian does not mean pants wearer. It means non-Greek. Oh.
Yeah, well, it means both. It means anybody who is not us. There is a names and titles section also in the handouts that we're not going to go into because it gets way too complicated, but it is there if you want to peruse it and figure out what you want to call people in the SCA or not. It's there as a resource. We're not even going to try to. There's just way too much. So anyway, go ahead and print those out when you have an opportunity. Okay, restored classical pronunciation. It's an attempt to speak Latin with the same pronunciation used during the heyday of ancient Rome. Thanks to the efforts of many scholars, we have a pretty good idea what Latin sounded like in classical times. And this is what's taught in most schools, high schools and colleges today. Like I said, 38 years ago, it was not. The Latin alphabet. As you read Latin, you're going to discover that their alphabet is a little bit different. As you can see here, they did not use lowercase letters, although most texts that you're going to encounter, whether it's on the internet or in books or whatever, they're going to go ahead and use lowercase letters because we're used to reading them. But if you actually go and look directly at things on statues and stuff, you'll notice that there are no lowercase letters. You have to figure it out for yourself. They also don't use modern punctuation, which, of course, is what we end up finding pretty much everywhere on the internet and in books and things. K, X, Y, and Z are only used when writing in Greek or for making Roman numerals. J, U, and W don't exist yet, and I and V are both consonants and vowels, depending on the context. So, the Roman alphabet is, repeat after me, ah.
Ah.
Come on, guys. Bay.
Bay.
K.
Bay.
K. Bay. K.
Day.
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 A.
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 F.
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 Gay.
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 Ha.
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 E.
E.
E. Ka.
Ka.
L.
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 M.
M.
N.
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 N. O.
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 A.
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 Ku.
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 This is one I can never do right. It's supposed to have an R roll. I have never been able to roll my R's very well, but R.
Er.
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 Er. S.
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 A.
T.
A.
U.
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 X.
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 Y.
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 And Zeta.
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 Okay, so classical Latin is highly phonetic, the words sound exactly as they're written. You need to enunciate all of the vowels. Try to not sound like you're pronouncing things like an American, which is hard for all of us. Two-syllable words always have the accent on the first syllable, which is almost the direct opposite from most the way we talk in America. We tend to put accents on the last syllable of things, especially when we're excited. Three-syllable words or more have the accent on the next to last syllable, unless that syllable is a long vowel or a diphthong, and then the accent is the third from the last syllable. You'll get the hang of it. It'll start sounding right. Why aren't my slides advancing?
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
You mentioned the handout. Is that the thing you're showing now, or is it some other documents?
These are pieces that have been pulled out of the handouts. The handouts are available on the TRU website.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, consonants. Basically the same as in English, except if you find the letters BS, it sounds like PS in Lats. BT is like PT in Sept. They have a lot of hard consonant sounds like that. C is always hard like a K, as in kick. G is always hard like in guard. H is always slightly enunciated like huff. I is U like in Yule. Q is like a KW, quah, that quick sound. R is always that rolled sound that I can't do. S is always a hard S as in C. T is always a hard T. V is like W, woot, which when you get to things like vivat trimeris, we pronounce it wrong for Latin. It should be vivat. So it's weird because we're used to pronouncing it vivat all this time. And yeah. X is always a KS sound as an X. Z, they hardly ever used. There was a originally, they borrowed it from the Greek, and they were trying to use it a lot, and then the people who were non-native Greek speakers, or who did not learn Greek, didn't have the ability to pronounce it, so they basically just stopped using it. CH is always a CH, as in chat. PH is a P, as in pin. And TH is a TH, as in think.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
You had talked about how we are doing classical pronunciation as opposed to liturgical pronunciation.
Right.
When did that switch happen historically?
It was a slow process. It started happening when the church kept Latin alive in Western Europe after the fall of Rome. So probably Charlemagne would have still been speaking classical Latin, but William the Conqueror probably was speaking ecclesiastical. So
okay.
Somewhere in there. And the ecclesiastical pronunciation has continued to evolve. So
okay. Right. Okay. My familiarity with Latin is singing, which religious music. So I'm assuming that's liturgical Latin.
Yes. I did my college work, bachelor's and master's work in medieval and Renaissance music, and all of that was also ecclesiastical. So yeah, 38 years of doing it wrong to try to unlearn.
Okay.
So, yeah, I hear ya.
Thank you.
Vowels: A as in ah. And father, E is always an A, as in hey. I is always an E, as in antique. O is always O, as in over. U is an oo, sound like in moon. For the short vowels, A is as in Clara, the us sound. E is eh, as in met. I is ih, as in hit. O is ah, as in off, and short, U is the as in put. Diphthongs are the AE, which is like aisle, I. AU is oo, as in house. EI is as in Dane, that A sound. EU is AU as in blue, and OE is oi as in oink. Y was another one of those words that they, or sounds that they really didn't use very much because it came from the Greek and it was very hard for non-Greek speakers. So this is fun. This is a professional, this is a PhD in Latin who's going to read this for you.
Omnes homines dignitate et iure liberi et pares nascuntur, rationis et conscientiae participe sunt, quibus inter se concordiae studio est agendum.
Okay, do you want to try that or do you want to hear it one more time?
One more time.
Omnes homines dignitate et iure liberi et pares nascuntur, rationis et conscientiae participe sunt, quibus inter se concordiae studio est agendum.
All right, let's take it one.
Omnes homines dignitate et iure liberi et pares nascuntur, rationis et conscientiae participe sunt, quibus inter se concordiae studio est agendum.
So for the rest of the class, we're going to have these handy little pronunciation guides. I did not invent this. Sometimes they're hard to use, but I find that they're very helpful as a reminder of how things are supposed to sound. So let's try it. Omnes.
Omnes.
Homines.
Homines.
Dignitate.
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 Et.
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 Iure.
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 Libere.
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 Et.
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 Pares.
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 Nascuntur.
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 Rationes.
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 Et.
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 Consciente.
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 Consciente. I did that wrong. Consciente.
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 Parte. Participes.
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 Sunt.
Sunt.
Quibus.
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 Inter.
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 Se.
Se.
Concordiae.
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 Studio.
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 Est.
Agendum.
Est. Agendum.
Agendum.
Let's try to do it all together as a sentence. So, ready? Omnes,
omnes,
homines,
dignitate,
et iure,
libere,
pares,
nascuntur,
rationes,
et conscientiae,
participe sunt. Good try. All right. So, see, it's hard.
But that is.
This one's more fun. All right. See if you can tell me what you think this is saying. Any guesses?
The cat.
Purr.
All right, let's try it. Mollis, Felis, Cauda, Felis, Globus, Cauda, Felix, Felis, Fisa, Felis, now, now, now.
That's awesome.
Hold on.
Somebody try it for me. Calpurnia, you're brave.
I'll do it if she doesn't.
Come on, guys.
I'll volunteer.
Molis Felis.
Moles, files, calda, files, Globus. Globus. Capile. Felix. Felis. Fisa. Felis. Now. 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 I like the last line.
Nailed it.
There you go. All right. So something a little harder. Just try to follow along. All right, we're doing right now is trying to get the sound into your ears. So this is another fun one. Try to stay up with it. It's going to give you all the lyrics as she sings them. So try to follow along and keep up with it. So you see how every single syllable gets pronounced? How did you guys do following along with that?
That's fun. I'm sure my husband's wondering what the heck's going on up here.
Okay, here's another one. This is slower and a little easier. You might try to sing along if you want. Mm-hmm. I wish I'd had this guy as my professor.
Heri omnes labores mei longe visi sunt, nunqui te tu quasi igmanent, credo in diem. Esternum subito, non sum de vidius viri quiera, es umbra supra me pendent, dies esternus venit subito. Nescio cur nec esse eset ei discedere dicere noluet. Dixi aliquid in iurio sum nunc diem esternum desidero. Heri amor erat nudis facilis lusum, nunc latrebae opus est mihi, credo in diem. Esterno, nescio cur nec esse eset, ei discedere dicere noluet. Dixi aliquid in iurio sum nunc diem esternum desidero. Heri amor erat nudus facilis lusum, nunc latrebae opus est mihi, credo in diem. Esterno.
So there's all kinds of learning songs and things that are on the on YouTube now and on the internet that they didn't have back in my day that would have been so useful. Okay, so moving on. No more fun stuff. Time to practice having intelligent conversations. So, salway. That's how you say hello to one person. Salway tays to more than one person. So if I'm saying hello to you, I say, salvete.
Salvete.
Salvete to everybody. If you want to say, hey friend, you have to make it, you have to specify whether it's a male friend or a female friend. In today's age, if you don't know what to do, I would default to male because that's basically the way the Latin language worked at that time. Everything defaulted to male. So if you're not sure, people have different personas. Don't know. Always default to male if you're not sure. But it's heus, amica, or amike. Heus is hi. So hi, heus. Hello, heus.
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 Heus. Heus.
Okay.
Hello.
All right. Uvales, how are you? To one person, ut valetes, if it's to more than one. So, you can see how these are pronounced. So, Calpurnia, ut valetes.
Valeo.
Is she still here? Pick one. You've got I'm fine and you. I'm thanks. I'm fine. So so. I'm tired.
It's two.
All right. Let's just do it this way. Repeat after me. Utwales.
Utuales.
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 How are you? Utualetes.
Utualetes.
That's how are you to more than one person. Waleo.
I'm Waleo.
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 And you, at two.
At two.
At two.
At two.
Okay. Gratias tibi. Ego quoque waleo.
Gratias
tibi. Gratias tibi.
Ego quoque waleo.
Good. You guys got it. Satis bene.
Satis bene.
Ad modum bene.
Ad modum bene.
Ad modum
bene.
Facis sum.
Facis
sum. Or for me, face sum.
Face sum.
Latrat slomacus.
Latrat
slomacus.
Slomacus. I'm hungry. It literally means my stomach is barking. That's another way to say it, which is asoreo. That also means I'm hungry, so asoreo.
Asoreo.
Laboro capite.
Laboro
capite.
I have a headache. You'll hear me say that at events a lot. Infirmus sum.
Infirmus
sum.
I don't feel very good. Or sum sicus.
Sum sicus.
I'm thirsty.
I have a question.
Yes.
Now, I think the rule was the second to last syllable on more than two syllables.
Uh-huh.
So, but it seemed like we were saying stomachus.
It depends.
Stomachus.
sorry, I'm losing my voice. The rule for more than two syllables is second to last unless that syllable is a soft vowel or a diphthong. In then case, it's the third from the last. So stomachus, because ma is short, is a soft vowel.
Oh, okay.
Stomachus. There were in the handouts. There are the syllable that gets the accent is in bold. But those didn't always, like, all of the markings and things translated over when I took the grids from the sheet onto the slides.
Okay.
All right, we're moving on. So what do you call somebody? This is something we have trouble with in the SCA. So do you recognize this name up here? Decimus Meridius Maximus. This is actually, I took this from Gladiator. This is not the name he gives, but this is the name he should have given. When he says, I am Maximus Meridius Decimus, which is the way you probably would have done it in Latin, Max Meridian the 10th.
Here we go.
So this is not me coming up with this. This is the same guy who did the translation of yesterday.
That's your response?
You told Osler we were a pair of cartoons.
So he determined that this would probably be Maximus's real name if he was Roman. So most men in the SCA take their names from the later Republican through the early Empire period. So they use the tria nomina, which means they have three names. The first name is your praenomen, your before name. Your second name is your family or clan name, and the last name is the cognomen, the by name. So that's how we get that set up. Men can add additional names. They're called agnomen, which literally means to name. And sometimes they would add additional names to this tria nomina. So you have a string of names that's all referring to one person. Agnomens could include like a nickname. Caligula was actually not Caligula's name. It was an agnomen. Caligula is a nickname referring to the little soldier's boots that he wore when he was a tiny tot and went on campaigns with his father. It could be a recognition for service to Rome. So there was a general who went by Germanicus because he had led a very victorious campaign in Germania. Or it could be a reminder of your original name, since one of the most common things to happen was there was no limit to age when it came to adoption in the Roman Empire. If you were getting older and you don't have any living male heirs, you could just adopt some other man, fully grown man, as your heir. And that happened more often than not. So, for example, Julius Caesar, his heir was Augustus Caesar. His heir, who was actually his great-nephew, I believe. So if Decimus Meridius Maximus was adopted by Julius Caesar, he would take on Julius Caesar's name. So he would become Gaius Julius Caesar, and then his agnomen would be Meridianus, to remind him of where he originally came from. And then he would determine which of those names he wanted to be called. So which name you use depends on the situation, how formal you want to be, or what kind of intimate terms you are with someone. So if you call somebody by all three names, you're being very formal. It's kind of like saying Mr. Maxwell Meridian the 10th, which, you know, might be what you call them if you're addressing a wedding invitation. That might be the name you use there, or if they're at a very formal reception. Most of the times, for our uses, SCA uses, that's what you would call somebody if you're calling them into court. We don't generally, at least in Trimeris, we don't refer to each other that formally. In an informal situation with someone you aren't particularly close to, that you don't count as a very close friend, you'd probably use their nomen, which is the middle name. And it's kind of the equivalent of calling each other by our last name. So like, I used to have a boss who, because he was former military, would never use my first name. He never called me Elizabeth. He never called me by my nickname, Libby. He called me Brooks. Always. I was always Brooks. So it's kind of the equivalent of that. And it didn't feel like it wasn't a formal thing. It was just that's just the way he was. He felt he didn't know me well enough, that we weren't on intimate enough terms for him to call me by my first name. So that's sort of a Romanish kind of feeling, where if you're on intimate terms, if you're close friends with somebody, then you're more comfortable calling them by their cognomen or their agnomen or a nickname if they choose to have one of those. Women, of course, being lesser beings, we didn't get to have the tria nomina. We only had two names. We had the nomen and the cognomen. But the same rules apply. Using both together is considered very formal. Using the nomen is considered less intimate, and using the cognomen is considered more intimate. But as you can imagine, if your name isn't static throughout the entire course of your life, and you've probably inherited it, you know, it's probably the same name that your father had and your brother had. And at least in the case of girls were given the feminized version of their father's name, especially in the Republic era, when they only had one name. So the daughter of the first born daughter of Julius is Julia. The second born daughter of Julius is also Julia. The third born daughter of Julius is also Julia. That's why you end up with people with like things like Julia the Elder, Julia the Younger, Julia the Third, Julia the Fourth, because you have to be able to differentiate between them somehow. But so Romans weren't really as attached to their names the way we are. It's kind of a weird difference. So they were more likely to use terms of endearment for each other if they were in a very close relationship, or some other, like a title or another form of address that talked about what their relationship was, like patron, patroness, teacher, mother, son, dear friend, things like that. So that there's a lot more about that in the handout, but that's just sort of a quick and dirty, when you're looking at someone's name, how to know what name to use. The other thing that's important about names is that when you see those names written, that's the names as they're presented on this page are in the genitive, which means we're talking about these people. So for my name, Marchia Dulcitia, that is the name that you say when you're talking about me. Or if I say, hi, I am Marquita Dulcitia, then I'm talking about myself. I'm not talking to me. When you're going to talk to me, you need to change everybody's name into the vocative. Now, it's not that hard. If a man's name ends in U.S., you change it to E. Like, remember the old line supposedly from Shakespeare, et tu, Brute? That's where that comes from. He's speaking to Brutus, not about him. So et tu, Brute. Marcus becomes Marque, Maximus, Maxime, Brutus becomes Brute. If the name ends in I-U-S, you change it to an I. So Julius becomes Yuli. Julius becomes Yuli. Lucius becomes Luci. Lucius becomes Luki. See, I'm doing it again. Addius becomes Addy. Luckily, women's names or any man's name that ends with an A, they don't change at all. So it's a lot easier for dealing with women in that respect. Sometimes there's advantages to being a subhuman on the men's Roman scale.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so, nomen mihi est Dulcitia. Again, it's in the genitive because I'm talking about myself. Ego sum Dulcitia. Again, I'm talking about myself. So, repeat after me. Nomen mihi est. Nomen mihi est. And put in your name. Nomen mihi est. What's your name?
Nomen mihi est Elizabeth.
There you go. Very good. Okay. Qui es tu? Who are you? Quid nomen tibi est? What is your name? Qui est tu?
Qui est tu?
Sum, I am Dulcia. That is my nickname. So I'm inviting you to call me by my nickname. Sum Dulcia. Habito Trimari. Sorry, habito trimari, trimari.
Habito trimari.
I will never get the pronunciations all corrected. Habito trimari, I live in Trimeris. Habito trimari. Ubi habitas, where do you live?
If we ever get, you ever get sucked into a time travel thing, you'll do better than a lot of us in Rome.
Okay. So we're going to move along. We're going to get into the section that I called in the handout. This is the way my friends and I actually talk to each other at events. Because the whole first part of the handout was all very polite. Hello, excuse me. You know, how to handle yourself with the list field, things like that. This is where we're actually talking. This is how we really talk to each other. So, O cucurbita, O pumpkin. O cucurbita.
O cucurbita.
Felis mala.
Felis mala.
Bad kitty. Felis bonum.
Felis bonum.
This is one that the philosopher will hear a lot. Transiet infants.
Transiet
infants.
Pass the baby. Attendite. Pay attention.
Attendite.
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 This is my favorite. Damihi ovium.
Damihi ovium. Oh, that'll be useful at sheep wars.
Yes. I always have my stuffed sheep with me in my cabin, and people try to steal it. So now you know what I'm saying. This is also useful. Et testudo, ubi est, ubi est. Et testudo ubi est. Where is the turtle?
Ubi est.
Et testudo ubi est.
Right. If you know my husband, you know his nickname is the turtle. Anasname. You love me?
Anasname.
Anasname.
Te amo. Te amo. I love you. This is probably more likely. Putote mimis molesti estis.
Putote mimis molesti estis.
I think you are very annoying.
Putote mimis molesti estis.
Nego! I am not!
Nego. No.
Okay, we use this a lot. Nancalor said, umor est qui nobis incommodat. It's not the heat, it's the humidity. Nancalor said, umor est qui nobis incommodat. Okay. D. Ekohora. Unsor meha me naka me nekabit. This is my husband's line. God, look at the time. My wife will kill me. How about this one? Esne. Repeat after me. Esne.
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 Volumen.
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 In.
In.
Toga.
Toga.
On.
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 Solum.
Solum.
TV.
TV.
Libet.
Libet.
May.
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 Videre.
Videre.
Is that a story? No. I'm just happy to see me. Kern will be saying this at the next event we have. Sentio aliquos togatos contra me conspirame. Conspirare. I think some people in togas are plotting against me. Because he has to step down soon. How about nihil?
Nihil.
Kura. Kuro,
Kuro.
Day.
Day.
Histatua.
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 Stulta.
Stulta.
Superstituone.
Superstituone.
I'm not interested in your dopey religious cult. This is good for bardics. Nulla metro compositum est. It doesn't rhyme. Nulla
metro compositum est.
I don't care if it doesn't rhyme, it isn't a poem. Good, good, good.
See, I'm trying to provide you with things that you can use in your everyday life and events.
That just sounds important.
This is the part that I was specifically asked for. Irumator.
Irumator.
Bastard. This one we can use a lot. Ruptuose.
Ruptuose.
Ruptuose. Belcher. Bois stercus.
Bois stercus.
Bullshit. Deodamnatus.
Deodamnatus.
Moika putite.
Moika
putite.
Putite. Putite day.
Sorry.
Day. That's a dirty slut. Asine.
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 Fatue. Fool.
Fatue.
Stulte.
Stulte.
One of my favorites that was this is an actual one that gets used a lot in the, apparently in the Roman army, fungi. to a group, like to a group of soldiers who are sitting here,
you mushrooms,
sitting around instead of doing things like they're supposed to. You call them a bunch of mushrooms.
Nice.
Yeah. Go ahead.
It's just funny. Yeah.
Apparently, calling someone a public toilet is also a really dirty. So, sterculinum publicum.
Sterculinum publicum.
Focusing
on. Doesn't have the same effect as yelling mushrooms.
Okay, so how you say "Oh my God" depends on what your religion is in ancient Rome. So you have the "O Deus Meus," you know, which is more like the modern. If you want to be truly Roman, if you're part of the, you know, the Roman religion, you would say, you know, "Mehercle," or Hercules. You're one of the gods. You're damning the gods. Take atque abi. Shut up and go away. Quam scortilium. Scortilum. Quam
scortilum.
What a bimbo. Quid stultus.
Quid stultus.
Stultus.
What an idiot. This is something I can imagine Severin saying. Quis est haec simia? Who is this monkey? This I think I've actually heard Melise say in English. Wa ete. Woe is you. Wa ete.
Wa ete.
Mater tua.
Mater tua.
Mater tua.
Obesa.
Ha obesa.
Obesa.
Es ut cum.
Es ut cum.
Es ut cum.
Romai.
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 Est orbs.
Est orbs.
Habet.
Habet.
Octocolis.
Octocolis.
Your mama is so fat, when she goes to Rome, it has 8 hills. Rome had 7 hills, 7 famous hills.
Auburn.
Okay, and we continue to get worse and worse. So, because this is what I was asked for. So, Ede fecam.
Ede fecam.
Ede fecam.
Fututus et morsi in igne.
Fututus et mori in igne.
Futui.
Futui! That one's nice and easy.
That's one of my favorites. Feix. It's also another easy one. Feix.
Feix.
Filius canis.
Filius
canis.
Now, I don't have anything referring to a bitch in here because the Romans didn't actually think of it that way. So if you're saying that somebody is the son of a dog, they're literally the son of a dog, not the kind of context that we put into that. Although they did have things like escortum obscenus vilis, which is you are a vile, perverted whore. You know, there's a fine art to swearing in Roman. So that's the end of my presentation. Do you have any questions that I can hopefully not answer?
And if she does, they're all in Latin.
It was incredibly informative.
It was very fun.
I feel like I learned everything I need to know about Latin, personally. So.
Well, that's why I gave you the book. Because the booklet actually, if you print it out as a booklet and staple it together, it has all of the various things, starting with the very nice things. And it has like what you can wanted to speak in Latin as you go up to the registration to check in and have gradually
get really sure.
But it also has pages for notes of where you can write down things for yourself. So you can highlight, it's all in grid form, so you can highlight your favorites so you can find them frequently. You know, something you can carry with you and have at events to add to the fun. So any other questions, comments?
Are you going to share links for those Latin videos, music videos? Those are pretty awesome.
Sure. There's a whole wealth of them. If you go onto YouTube and put popular songs sung in Latin language, all of this stuff comes up. And then if you're studying, if you happen to be like me and you're crazy and you're actually trying to study Latin to relearn it or to learn it for the first time, there are a bunch of videos that will also come up that are like Latin conjugation song and the Latin tenses song and all of these things that high school especially, but high school teachers have done that are really, that to help their students, but I find them to be incredibly useful myself too. So, you know, contact me at any point in time and I will be happy to share links for these things because they're just, it's a really fun way to get a handle on another language.
Right. I guess that kind of answers my next question is, if you want to learn Latin on your own, what's kind of a good resource other than your handouts?
There's actually, in the handout, at the end that where I have resources and stuff, there's actually a list of different places. So one of the things that there's a whole bunch of different kind of dictionaries and I give you links for them in the handout. One of them, especially if you're working on being able to speak, is sound language, a sound dictionary where you type in the word and it gives you the classical pronunciation.
I like that.
Yeah, so that's really neat. So a lot of the others are, you know, that you either put in the Latin or you put in the English or whatever, and they give you information about when the word was developed, how frequently it was used, what the declensions are, things like that. So you can see, you know, all of the things that you need to know if you're going to try and translate on your own. Those are all really important things to have. I have some sources that have like step-by-step. The National Archive has a Latin language, a free Latin language course. So you can go in there and you can download their materials and you can actually work your way through the course. Also places, things like Duolingo and stuff are starting to have conversational Latin. But the thing that I was doing Duolingo for a while, but it was frustrating to me because I already had a background in Latin and they weren't teaching any grammar. They were just throwing conversations at you. And so having already had a background in the language, I found that actually harder to use because I was trying to look for things in the way they have it set up that weren't there. But if you don't have any background in the language, that's actually a good way to become semi-conversational in it. They're not going to have a lot of SCA applicable words, obviously, but you know, you can spend a lot of time talking to Marcus. Anything else? Did I answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Sure. Anybody else?
And it's 1:00 right now, just FYI.
So we need to go. Thank you, everybody.
And, no problem. For a fabulous and fun class.
Yeah.